Could you tell us, please, where to begin with development of a fishing rod?
I believe that everything starts with a problem. The development of any product is intended to solve a problem, which involves achieving some kind of a goal by a consumer. Which goal does an angler have? His goal is to catch fish in particular conditions, with a special bait and with a certain technique. This is the problem that we solve. I've traveled a lot recently. I fish in different places and conditions, and I'm constantly facing the problem of lack of a tackle for catching a certain fish in a particular place with a particular lure that I have now. Hence, there's a need for developing such a tackle, which would be suitable for these conditions, and thus solving the problem. Nowadays, our rods are used worldwide. So on one hand, we solve my own problem. On the other hand, we help to achieve goals those anglers who are fishing in their regions. The conditions in our region do not change. In fact, they're constant, and it looks like everything has been already invented. However, trends are changing constantly. New fishing styles appear, or forgotten ones become popular again. And our anglers need solutions depending on these trends. Basically, we meet these demands, if we speak about our domestic market. The next stage is called the search for ideas. A new idea can appear any time, but usually we find it during the fishing process. I believe that practice matters and that it is important to be involved in fishing. When you are fishing, you understand that the tackle works not as you would like to, and suddenly you get an idea of how to change it for the better. For example, many anglers like to put a finger on the rod blank. That's why many rods have very short foregrips. But if we are going to catch a big fish in the sea, we need some support for fighting. Very often, a short foregrip is just inconvenient. Hence, practice is so important for us to detect the problem and to find a solution. Of course, the ideas do not appear from nowhere. We constantly visit special exhibitions, follow new technologies and inventions in the world of fishing tackle. Thus, we accumulate a kind of a database in our memory, which can be used for the ideas to be extracted later. As soon as we have an idea, we can move on with a concept. If we speak about a rod, it consists of two components, the rod blank and wrapping. We prepare a technical project for the blank and send it to the factory, where engineers make drawings and prepare a sample. The wrapping is the visual design of the rod. Design not only means color, fonts or logos, but also the handle design as well, its shape, size, ergonomic features and everything that we can touch and see. We start with simple sketches. We can draw them even on a sheet of paper. This is the way we're looking for the shape and general appearance of the end product. Further, we specify all the details. We also use 3D visualization because we want to see the three-dimensional shape of the product. Sometimes we even print it on a 3D printer in order to touch it. We do so because we apply non-standard solutions very often, and we want to check the live look. At the same time, we're developing the visual style of the rod, the colors and logos. Actually, it's a complicated, labor-intensive, and time-demanding process, which involves many people. Not only am I engaged in it, but also all the designers in our team. The most important is to keep in mind the functionality of the rod, because design is design, but the rod is a product that will be used by people. It must perform its function. That's all that really matters. The first samples are tested at the factory. By means of special equipment, we perform crash tests and find out how powerful the rod is and which loads it can handle. Then we get the samples and test them live on the water bodies. We do it on our own, as well we have a lot of external pro staff members. People who test our samples worldwide. They test rods in their conditions and inform us about the improvements that are needed. From the very first specimen and until the final sample, many intermediary samples exist. Thus, we will make changes until we are completely satisfied with the achieved result. Finally, we get the final sample and start the production. Everything starts in this huge fridge where prepreg is stored. Prepreg is a composite material that consists of carbon fibers and resin. It can have different modularity, structure, and fibers direction. The prepregs that we use the most are Japanese Tori and Korean Skyflex. When we need to make a sandwich from different kinds of prepreg, we use a special rolling press for that. Prepreg is used to make rod patterns, which are wound on the mandrel. It's a steel rod with particular tapering, which determine the future geometrical shape of the rod blank. It's very important to have its surface polished and defect-free. Generally, mandrels have their life cycle, and after a particular number of rod production cycles, we need to order new ones. There's one important detail in wrapping of prepreg on the mandrel. We don't use one sheet of prepreg. We combine different kinds of prepreg with different features. And this is our MLS technology, multi-layer blank structure. If needed, we apply special carbon stripe to reinforce the blank from both inside and outside. Further, the composition of mandrel and prepreg is wrapped with a special plastic stripe. A special machine wraps the strip very densely. By the way, the rib structure, which you can often observe on the blank, is a trace of the plastic stripe. Then this construction is sent into an oven for thermal treatment. There are two important factors to consider here. The first one is temperature. It's not constant. A special pattern of temperature fluctuation is created depending on the prepreg used. The second factor is the oven height. The higher the oven is, the longer one piece blank we can make. It's important for American market because they use one-piece rods. Our ovens allow us making up to 3 meter long one-piece rods. After the thermal treatment, the mandrel is taken out of the blank and the blank is polished. There's one detail to consider. If there is a clear ribbed structure on the blank, it means that the blank has not been polished or has been polished very slightly. If the blank surface is smooth, it means that the blank has been polished very significantly. Sometimes it's not good because the blank walls become thinner and the blank becomes more fragile. That's why the majority of our rods are either not polished at all or polished minimally. Quality control is one more important detail. All blanks undergo several stages of quality control after polishing. We check if the surface on the blank is even, test it for fracture. At this stage, we also find the seam, which we can use later. After that, the rod blanks are painted. We prefer not to paint the entire blank, especially for light rods. It has a negative impact on weight and structure of the rod. Then we print logo and decals on the blank, and finally, we cover it with varnish. Further, we assemble a handle on the blank. It's a manual process, and the process is rather labor-demanding. It is important to use a sufficient amount of epoxy for a handle to be solid and the reel seat to be well fixed. But at the same time, it should be done very carefully to avoid the epoxy leaking. The handle should be clean and beautiful. The quality of the components is important too. Cork, EVA, and metallic parts are ordered from external manufacturers. That's why it's important to select good suppliers and to perform quality control of separate components. In general, when we speak about the rod quality, it's a combination of small details. And in order to have a high-quality end product, we need to pay attention to every detail. The final stage of a rod assembly is the installation of guides. The guides are installed depending on the rod seam and the guide mapping determined at the stage of sample development. The guides are tied to the blank and coated with several layers of varnish. The rod parts are sent to special drum dryers. Around 100 of rods can be placed on each drum. This is their main difference from the dryers used by our rod builders. When the varnish is dry, quality control procedure of guides will be performed. We verify if they are straight. Then the rods will be assembled. In order to do this, we adjust the joints. They're cleaned and ready for us to provide the final quality control procedure. We visit the factory in order to do this. After control procedure has been performed, the rods are packed in bags, arranged in boxes, and are sent around the world. Finally, the most important part for me are people who fish with our rods. This is the final stage in the rod creation. When you see that anglers fish with your rods, that they are solving their problem, and that the rods perform their function, only then you understand that you have done everything right.